breath in. Deep breath out. Invite us to enter into a time of collective meditation, out of which we will close. Gather together a community of faith, believers in action and impact, believers in community and compassion. We are living in a time awake. The politeness charade have ended. There is truth sounding on every corner. May we breathe in and breathe out. May we know that we are held by a vast web of love. May we breathe in and breathe out. May we know that we are not alone. May we breathe in and breathe out and find courage together. So may it be. A poem by Maya.
We, this people, a small and lonely planet, traveling through casual space, past aloof stars, across the way of different suns, to a destination where all signs tell us it is possible and imperative that we learn in brave and startling truth. And when we come to it, to the day of peacemaking, when we release our fingers from fists of hostility to allow pure air to cool our palms,
we, this people on this small and drifting planet, whose hands can strike with such abandon that in a twinkling, life is sapped from the living. Yet those same hands can touch with such feeling, irresistible tenderness, that the haughty neck is happy to bow, and the proud back is glad to bend. Out of such chaos, of such contradiction, we learn that we are neither devil nor divine.
When we come to it, we, this people on this wayward floating body, created on this earth, of this earth, have the power to fashion for this earth a climate where every human can live freely, without sanctimonious piety, without crippling fear. When we come to this, we must confess that we are the possible, we are the miraculous, the true wonder of this world. That is, when, and only when, we come to it.
I'm going to invite you to join me in a brief part of the breathing meditation by Sarah Gann Jones, created after the events of 9/11 in 2001. I invite you to sing with me. Breathe in,
Thank you.
llamas, a story that concludes, oh, and it's not true. This story of llamas was created by Cameron Hurley in her essay, We Have Always Fought, Challenging the Women, Cattle, and Slave Narrative, published in May of 2013. As a young white woman working on her master's degree, she went to South Africa with the hope of studying the women resistance fighters of apartheid. When her advisor asked her why she had chosen to come so far to study this particular subject, she explained she was very enthusiastic about studying a movement with women leaders, since women have never been hard-fighting forces. Her advisor quickly interrupted her gushing to make sure she knew that women have always fought. Everywhere, not just in South Africa. Women have always fought, black lives have always mattered, undocumented immigrants have always been human beings, not aliens. Islam contains the same spectrum of peace and violence as every other major world religion. Human activity has always had an impact on this planet. Gender has always existed on the spectrum, and people have always loved across and around and through that gender spectrum. But these are not the stories that fill our narratives, our media, our common cannibalistic llama stories. I mean, even if you've never heard the story of Israeli cannibalistic llama, I'm sure you've heard the story of weak women who must be protected from themselves, savage people of color, Muslim terrorists, useless, really, maybe you haven't heard that story. Marriage as a sacred union only between a man and a woman. These narratives are alive and they're amplified in our culture, in our politics, in our creative arts, the media, in the email chain, my goodness, the email chain, and of course, in our history books. And my friends, we are called, as a people of faith, to resist these narratives. We are called to rebuke the patriarchy, to undo racism, to celebrate, affirm, and promote multi-faith, multi-gender, multi-generational communities. Sometimes we sing and speak about building bridges, but at a deeper level, at a self-principle level maybe, we know that we're already interconnected, an interdependent web of existence. Much of our faithful work is in clearing away the illusions and social constructions that lead us to divided and isolated lives. Friends, llamas are not scaly, cannibalistic, living-like sea creatures. At least not the ones I've met. And it is this embodied knowing and caring for and loving people who are denied access to legitimate power that allows us to resist the coercive narratives of oppression. Increasingly, I've organized with white elders who have come to the Center for Ethical Living and Social Justice Renewal to learn about embracing an anti-racist worldview, because through marriage or adoption, they now have grandchildren of color. After years of being lulled into inaction by this unrelenting dominant narrative that racism is a problem for people of color, these white elders have been awakened to their own complicity in systemic oppression, awakened to a new narrative through their relationship with actual people of color whom they love. They are rarely comfortable in the work of resistance, but they are filled with joy. Earlier this year, my colleague, Reverend Jake Morrell, who serves the Unitarian Universalist Congregation in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, shared the following reflection called Sticking It Out in the Storm. He wrote, I pray not for comfort, nor deliverance that would leave others to drown. A white man has choices that others do not. So I pray to be disturbed, to stay awake, to stick it out in the storm, because I don't want the cheap grapes of self-gratification. I want what comes to those who stay out in the storm, the spirit that races through and fills the whole room. I want liberty and justice for all in my country. That will ask of me and many of you the discipline of discomfort, May we be found in the storm through the night, trusting that if we are faithful, if we don't check out too soon, where there was suffering and sorrow, there will one day be joy. And that, after a long night, the morning will come. Friends, people's lives are more just and more equitable because we raise our voices collectively. This is the theory of change in our Standing on the Side of Love campaign, the theory of change that invites us to stay in the struggle together, whatever our personal relationship to how power is arranged in our denominational association, known as the Unitarian Universalist Association, and our places of work, in this country, in this world. After the 2016 presidential election in the United States, Caitlin Breedlove, who was the former campaign director of the Standing on the Side of the Love campaign, reminded us that we are now in a new political terrain, but one that exists within centuries of old struggles and organized resistance around the questions of who has the right to resist, the right to lead, and the right to remain. What is being lifted up to the Unitarian Universalist Association about our hiring practices and our power structures is not a new struggle. What is being lifted up to our congregations about our membership and our hiring practices is not a new struggle. Racism, anti-blackness, sexism, homophobia, gender discrimination, inaccessibility, Islamophobia, these are not new struggles. These struggles have been deep and real for a long time now, and if you're finding yourself newly woken to these struggles, welcome, friends. And please take the time to study the resistance work that's been going on. And if you've been in the struggle for the long haul, thank you. And please celebrate that your faithful resistance has made this moment possible. Friends, people's lives are more just and more equitable because we raise our voices collectively. I'm grateful this morning for the presence of the members of the General Assembly Planning Committee of our Unitarian Universalist Association. Thank you, friends, for your faithful service. General Assembly, also known as GA, and it does not stand for Georgia like I thought when I first moved here. GA is an annual gathering of Unitarian Universalists, and it's one place where we practice our religious community on a very large scale. While there are a few truly large Unitarian Universalist congregations, most GU congregations have less than 200 members. So among the many gifts and opportunities, General Assembly is a place where Unitarian Universalists get to practice being in faithful relationships with thousands of UUs. And while practice does not necessarily make perfect, so I heard Bennett Pratt promise that to choir with him, by Wednesday you'll be perfect. Experience, it does make progress, right? Practice makes progress. How about that? Many years ago, after a particular series of General Assembly experiences that were harmful and exclusionary for many people of color and those with access struggles, collective voices requested, slash demanded, accountability from our UUA, and a special review commission was convened. And I want to share with you today the heart of their final report, the spiritual reflection and faithful commitment upon which they agreed after struggling in discomfort together. This is not about me, Ted. This is about people. This is about relationships. This is about power. This is about how we treat each other. This is about communication. This is about the assumptions we make about each other. This is about how we handle conflict. This is about human limitations and fragility. This is about the myths of our accomplishments and denial of our failures. This is about entitlement across a broad spectrum and at all levels. This is about a theological understanding of covenant. This is about sin, confession, penance, and absolution. This is about owning our own history and learning from that history. This is about creating and sustaining a religious covenanted community. This is about hope and love, and pain, and tears, and love, and hope again. This is about never forgetting and letting go. This is about humility. This is about the future. This is about all of us. This is about all of us, friends. Wherever we happen to live, whatever identities we inhabit, when we resist the narrative of scaly cannibalistic llamas, or any of the fear and hate-filled narratives about other members of our beloved community, we are engaged in the faithful work of resistance. And as we heard in Maya Angelou's poem earlier this morning, when we come to it, we, this people on this wayward floating body, created on this earth, of this earth, have the power to fashion for this earth a climate where every human can live freely without sanctimonious piety, without crippling fear. General Assembly will be held in New Orleans June 21st through 25th this year. Y'all are cordially invited. I mean, seriously, go to UUA.org and get registered now. And big shout out to Jolanda Walter. This is the first time General Assembly has ever been hosted in Louisiana. And the Center for Ethical Living and Social Justice Renewal has served as a local coordinating partner for the National Planning Committee. It's going to be held in the Ernest Morial Convention Center. Some of you know the investor of the first Black Mayor of New Orleans. And the theme decided upon way last year in a process that actually still eludes my understanding, but has a very satisfactory outcome. The theme is resist and rejoice. Resist and rejoice, my friends. We are so clear that there is much to resist in this moment, hatred and bigotry, destruction, personal and systemic oppression, and we know and must remember as a collective that there can be much joy in resisting. And we got to take time for that. The singing, the dancing, the playing, the creating, the social justice aerobics, the parades, the dinners with friends, the running if you do that, the fishing, the hiking, the grandkids, the writing, the meditating, the loving. Wherever it is that you find joy, honor its place as a priority in your life. Joy is essential for faithful resistance to oppression. We know a thing or two about the sustaining power of collective joy in your minds. Resist and rejoice, my friends. In beloved community, so much is possible. In the Christian community, today marks the beginning of Holy Week, Palm Sunday, the day that a spirit-filled organizer rode into Jerusalem with a promise of resistance. We have stories and experience and models and dreams of a multi-faith, multi-racial, multi-generational, multi-possible world. We know that llamas are not scaly, cannibalistic, living white creatures. We affirm that every human being has inherent worth and dignity, that we exist in an interdependent web of all existence. May we find the courage to raise our voices collectively for the co-creation of a more just and equitable world for everyone. Resist and rejoice, my friends. This is holy work, and we are not alone. At this time, you are invited to reach into your heart and into your wallet and your purses to sustain the beloved community that is CCUU, a place where you can know every week that you are not alone. I've been an anthem of the standing on the side of love campaign. I bet it says it's fun to me. Coming to you with page 1014, standing on the side of love, and invite your ride and fire spirit.
Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your life. Thank you for your love. Amen.